gamut for quashing of the proceedings. We all know, since majority of us are lawyers, that registration of FIR itself sends fears within the entire family, friends, etc., etc. And a lawyer who can get the bail is considered to be a good lawyer. And a lawyer who can get the quashing of the FIR, he is the best lawyer. And if we can learn the nuances as to how the FIR could be quashed, what are the parameters, nothing like it. We all know that Mr. Bali has been expert. His inputs, his entire team is well known for all these facts. Before we said that the places at where we have all faltered, where we couldn't even get the bails, he's been able to manage to get the FIR squashed. Let's try to learn these nuances during all these times. If my wish could have been actually fulfilled, I would have asked that Mr. Bali could have been appointed amicus and his team, so that they could get this COVID-19 and the pandemic itself quashed. I just wanted that if we could unlock that and get this all quashed. Mr. Bali, back to you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Prakashji, and your entire team. I am, first of all, very thankful to you to have given me this opportunity.
Hello.
Can I be heard?
Sir, I'm just muting everybody for a minute. I will be muting you also, and thereafter I'm unmuting you. Yes, Mr. Bali, back to you.
I can speak now?
Yeah.
All right. Vikasji, first of all, I just wanted to thank you for bringing me on this platform. And I think it's a very interesting, venture which you have got into, which actually, we people are so much working almost 16, 17 hours every day. And suddenly, we are not working at all and it's not summer vacation. And nobody's traveling, so it is a very very well thought of venture by you, and it is actually I think a lot of inputs from legal illuminaries and people who can really contribute in the field of law, because law is something which we don't get enough time for in the whole system of our institution. We are so much preparing, drafting cases. The courts are so heavily burdened. So law is something which I think has taken a back seat, and I think this platform is outstanding, and I just congratulate you and your team to have started this.
You can start with your this thing. That's
yes. Important. Now, you see, though I have worked on various fields of law, and if somebody has to talk about me and they say criminal law, they would normally say, criminal law basically may not be something which is at my backyard. But you see, section 482 of the CRPC, it is quite akin to constitutional rights and constitutional remedies under Article 226, what the Constitution provides for us. Now, why 482 is a very, very important provision in the Criminal Procedure Code, and how the courts have looked at it from a point of view when we got our independence and we framed our constitution, and we had constitutional courts, the high courts who would entertain petitions under 482. But the background is very serious, which people generally do not go into. You see, all these criminal basic major acts, which we are now utilizing in our day-to-day situation for criminal acts, they are all pre-independence. Now, you see the situation when IPC was enacted and CRPC was enacted in the late 18th century, 1870s and 80s. We were ruled by the British. The uprising was coming along. People were speaking against the British rule. So how did the British wanted to tackle them? They wanted to tackle them by putting a provision in the CRPC that any offense which is reported must be reduced into writing and an FIR should be registered. And then making so many offenses which were non-bailable so that a person can be immediately, there can be a case registered against a person and he can be immediate, action can be taken against him immediately. Though in 1973, we did have a whole hog amendment of the CRPC. We kept the provisions of section 154, 155 and 156 alive. So in India, like in any developed country, we do not have a situation when an offense is reported, there is a scope of a preliminary inquiry or an investigation, and every cognizable offense has to be reported, if reported, has to be registered into a first information report. Now, that is where the difficulty of the modern times start, because you see, in modern times, we do not have those orthodox criminal activities which were there in the 18th century, like, let's say, bodily harm, physical harm, dacoity, robbery, theft. Nowadays, the scope of criminal, any criminal offense is so much correlated to a civil offense, to a financial offense, to an offense which is which can be fought in arbitration, which can be fought in civil court, but sometimes it is given a criminal color. And then the legislation which provides for an immediate arrest. So, like Vikasji started his discussion by saying that there is a social stigma attached to registration of an FIR. Yes, it is. Not only a social stigma, you will apply for a job somewhere, you will have to write, is there any case registered against you? And you know, once a case is registered, it is not going to get over within 7 or 8 years or 4 years or 5 years if it goes to trial. Then you apply for a passport, you have to write, is there a case registered against you? So there are so many strings attached to registration of a case against an individual. And ultimately, the situation is, what does a person do? And fortunately for us, Section 482, and even a bigger power for quashing of an FIR, which I say people very, very seldom utilize, is the provision of Article 226 of the Constitution, which does not bar you from filing a petition challenging an absolutely bogus criminal investigation against you or a case against you. So had our legislators thought about this situation, that registration of an FIR and a person's imminent arrest after it for a cognizable offense and a non-bailable offense is something that they have to look after and give some trust to the police and the police power to have some kind of a preliminary investigation, so that useless FIRs are not registered, A. B, a person is not harassed. And C, that you always talk about the fact that the acquittal rate is so high in this country. It is high because the registration of the FIRs are, a lot of bogus FIRs are registered. That's why the acquittal rate is high. So had the legislation provided for this provision that there has to be a preliminary inquiry, and you know there's a constitutional bench judgment by Lalita Kumari, in Lalita Kumari's case, the Supreme Court has made some exceptions where a preliminary inquiry, like in a matrimonial case, in a financial dispute, etc., can be done, though it is almost entering into a realm of legislation. But it is a basic defect of our legislation to register an FIR without even holding a preliminary inquiry, which actually, I feel, is a very, very important aspect, which empowers the high courts under Section 482 and Article 226 to entertain a petition for quashing of criminal proceedings. Now, you see, there is a situation which we face as citizens and especially as lawyers and even as litigants, that unfortunately for us, the law in our country is not very static. When I say law, I mean the judgments. So you'll have a consistent situation where the top court will, with the passage of time, let's say about 5 years or a cycle of 7 years or 10 years, will normally change its outlook about a certain provision of law. It has happened in civil jurisprudence. It has happened in the situation in relation to second appeals under the Civil Procedure Court. It has happened in relation to arbitration, it has happened in relation to so many provisions. And you see, the initial Magna Carta judgment, which came on quashing of the FIR, was State of Haryana versus Bhajanlal. In Bhajanlal, 7 exceptions are culled out. as to how an FIR should be quashed, what the court should see, which says that if prima facie reading of the FIR does not make out a case, quash the FIR. Then it says if there's a vexatious litigation against somebody, quash the FIR. Then they say that the examples are not exhaustive in nature. There can be special circumstances the court can look into. For quashing an FIR, there could be technical reasons. There could be non-following of a particular provision under special statutes, etc. And though in 1982, under the Price States Funds Act, in Swapnil Kumar Guha's case, the Supreme Court quashed an FIR under that provision because the FIR was not properly written. But basically, the Magna Carta for quashing the FIR stems and originates from State of Haryana versus Bhajanlal. I would have actually wanted the law to get more established on this procedure of Section 482, exercising the right of quashing. We have judgments given by the Supreme Court in Madharao Jivaji Sindhya's case, in which an ex-director was involved and then proceedings against him was quashed because he had got nothing to do with the crime. Then we have Mahato's case. Mahato's case says that even after the charge sheet, you can entertain a petition for quashing. Then we have a judgment which says that documents of unimpeachable character can be looked into for quashing of an FIR. And then lately, a very famous judgment by our court. I was very lucky to be a part of the team arguing that matter. Tupperware versus Union Territory Chandigarh, which ultimately has been upheld by the Supreme Court, which I think in the modern times is the most dynamic judgment on quashing of FIR, where I feel that the courts should play a very proactive role in looking into a litigation which has been initiated for criminal purposes, which actually smells of vindictiveness, smells of a civil dispute, smells of something which should never go for a criminal trial. But as our situation is, unfortunately, the legislation does not support a very dynamic judicial introspection into the situation of quashing of an FIR. Because our legislation, which is absolutely dated on registration of an FIR, still says cognizable offense reported must be reduced into writing, reported by anybody, reported anywhere. Only thing is that under Section 173, subsection 8, it has to be transferred to a proper police authority, having jurisdiction over that area where the offense has been committed. So, what are we doing here? We are, by this kind of unnecessary registrations of FIR, overburdening the criminal system, overburdening the trial courts, and actually serious offenses like drugs, offenses under NDPS acts, offenses under financial legislations, big people walking away with white collar crimes, they all get a seat at the back burner because so much of unnecessary registration of FIRs, which floods the criminal courts and does not give an opportunity to the criminal court to actually give time for expeditious justice, which is very important for finishing a trial against an accused who's actually guilty, that his trial should get over within a period of maximum 2 years and he should be brought to the book. So the hands of the justice system is sometimes curtailed by the fact that an FIR becomes a necessary to be registered. And ultimately, the courts have to go by the statute, the legislation. The primary duty of the courts is not to legislate, but to uphold the legislation. Now, within this small fragment of scope which you have under 482 or Article 226 for quashing a criminal proceedings, what should the court do? What should the court do? And my honest opinion as a lawyer is that lately the approach of the courts is very technical. It is, I have read the FIR, so FIR discloses a cognizable offense, so it's not a good case for quashing. It should be dismissed. Then let the matter go to trial. And you, as lawyers, must have faced the situation that you go to a court and you argue, sir, this is the most ridiculously registered FIR. I mean, this is a purely civil case. There was an agreement to, I'm just giving an example. There was an agreement to sell. And in this agreement to sell, what happened was that I forfeited the amount. I forfeited the amount and the person goes and registers an FIR against me under section 420 or maybe 467, 471. What is this happening? So the Honorable Court will sometimes tell you, counsel, it is just a preliminary stage. So why don't you let the investigation report be filed under section 173? And then you, as a lawyer who wants to have oxygen in his case for your client, will say, all right, I'm going to withdraw it and I'll come when the charge sheet is filed. So you go to the court and you say that the charge sheet is filed. And the court will tell you, now the charge sheet is filed. Now there is an investigation against you. So why don't you argue all of this at the time of framing of a charge? So you'll again say, all right, my lord, I want to take back my petition and I'll argue after the charge is framed. So the charge is framed when you come back for quashing and the court says, charges have been framed, now file a revision. Now, I'm sure a lot of you must have experienced this situation where I feel that the court definitely has to be proactive in exercising powers under section 482. Whatever benefit we can get out of judgments like State of Haryana versus Bhajan Lal and judgments which have lately come, like Tupperware's judgment, like I'm sorry, I just can't remember the citation of a latest judgment which has come in which they have actually looked into registration of a case against bank employees when they went to take possession of a property of somebody. So, I feel that the courts have to be more active in looking into the situations. I really feel that matters which are purely of civil dispute, matters which can be argued in civil court, matters which are, I'm sorry if I'm saying so, matters in relation to matrimonial disputes, in which the entire family, the whole family's cousins, everybody is involved. And if you go into that system to say that, look here, reading of the FIR discloses a cognizable offense against you, who does not know that in all these civil related matters which go to criminal court, the FIR is not registered by a person who is giving an information. The FIR is prepared and drafted by a lawyer having a very, very good legal experience to ensure that it is written down so well that if you just read it and the benches go by the fact that just reading of the FIR does disclose a cognizable offense, therefore face the trial, there will be no case for quashing of an FIR. So, I feel that this provision, though, should never be misused, should be looked into by the courts very carefully on a case-to-case basis. And I feel in a case where the court feels that a criminal trial or a criminal case has been instituted in a manner or it should not have been instituted, I feel it's the court's bounden duty to finish that unnecessary prosecution right away. It will help taking the load off the criminal courts. It will give a message to the general society that you will not be victimized under the garb of a criminal case. And it will deter people from using the course of criminal prosecution to settle scores amongst people. But yes, of course, while doing so, the courts also have to be very, very careful not to enter into an arena where basically while quashing of an FIR, you're actually holding a trial. So as long as that is segregated, and there are many cases, I mean, there are many cases in which there should be a trial, but where you will need very intrinsic evidence where you know that this is not a case for quashing. This is actually a serious trial which can go both ways. And once a quashing petition is before the court, I mean, the courts are manned by people who are constitutionally appointed. I'm talking about the high courts and the Supreme Court. And men of very great and vast legal knowledge, experience if they come from the lower judiciary, and also experience that they have been lawyers. So they know exactly that this is the case. Ultimately, if it goes to trial, there can never be a conviction in this case. Why should that case or that criminal prosecution proceed ahead? That's my very strong conviction about utilization of Section 482 for quashing of an FIR. And yes, of course, when you say gamut of Section 482, then we also go into free and fair investigation. We file petitions for that. We file petitions for protection. We file petitions where we feel that your basic rights under Article 21 are being violated for a situation which has a criminal color. So there is a large scope as far as 482 is concerned, but a step ahead is Article 226, which I feel should be used much more. I was a part of a matter which I did long time back when I was not even designated as a senior advocate. I had about 7 years of practice. It was in the Supreme Court. And this was in relation to quashing of an FIR on a basis of a compromise, B.S. Joshi versus State of Haryana, where ultimately the Supreme Court upheld the law to say that yes, compoundable, non-compoundable will not make a difference. The High Court can exercise powers under Section 482. But the court categorically said that 482 may be having a smaller scope. There may be technicalities. 482 says anything in relation to the code, that is the criminal procedure code, where the High Court can exercise its powers. But 226 is much wider. So I feel that as lawyers, whenever you feel that you have a limitation in filing a petition under Section 482, please invoke Article 226. So I think that's the whole spectrum of what I wanted to say. And if anybody has any questions, you can come along. Yes, Vikas ji.
I have a question.
Who's this, please? Anybody who speaks to me, can you just give me your introduction first?
I'm Advocate Monita Mehta. I've just put on the video. So please throw light on quashing of FIRs in non-cognizable offences. Offences under 302 and in this case.
Tapan?
Anji, Anji, ek minute ruko.
Just give me voice powers or my questions are from mute. हेलो
हाँ जी हाँ जी
होस्ट पावर्स दे दो मेरे को और मैं सबको म्यूट करता हूँ
एक मिनट बना दी सर दे देगा होस्ट आपको
Mr. Bali? Hello? Mr. Bali? Amit? Mr. Bali, probably you have muted yourself. Mr. Bali? Hello. I'm reading the questions. We are so sorry. We never knew that you had... we knew that you were popular, but we never imagined that people will just keep on doing despite our best efforts. We had not been able to increase the participants. So no, one day we will again request you, since you have a vast knowledge, that you will again have to promise us to come back on the board. 482 is a vast subject that we cannot do it. I will be just reading the questions meanwhile, and some of the lawyers have been kind enough to post the judgments which you were referring time and again. First question, according to me, is...
Yes.
Just hold on. These participants are... In any case, one goes, two are ready to bargain. Mayank Gupta asks, why, according to you, the power under Section 482 is limited to the High Court only and not to the Lower Judiciary? What is your take on it?
The provision itself says the High Court, so obviously the Lower Judiciary cannot entertain it.
Yeah. And Rajiv Joshi
starts by saying that notwithstanding anything contained in this court, the High Court in extraordinary circumstances can enter into a realm. So it's only the High Court who can enter into the court.
Okay. And the next question is by Rajiv Joshi. Do you think that the absence of provisions in the Code of Criminal Procedure to chastise or compel compensation in case of failed prosecutions where courts come to the conclusion that the entire case was falsely planted by the prosecution has actually aided the registration of the false FIRs?
Yes, I feel that's a very, very valid point, and I will absolutely endorse the idea there has to be better compensation awarded in false prosecution. See, you have provisions of Section 182, right? You have where you can actually... Somebody has initiated a false prosecution against you, there can be proceedings under 182. But you see, the compensation in our country is unreal. It is for a false trial, maybe a court will say the person is acquitted and the state is awarded, he's awarded cost of 10,000 normally. Or in a criminal complaint not initiated by the police, like provisions of Section 200, etc., where you have a pre-trial evidence and you give your statement and then the court, after recording evidence, summons you under Section 204. What is it? It's pittance. And even if you will go to file a case of damages in the civil court, you will have court fee, and the damages again will take about 10 years down the line after the trial is over. And damages, what you will get quantified, will be absolutely miserable. But look at the damage it causes you. False FIR. If you are known a little bit in the society, you make a news in the paper. If you are better known, then it's the front page. Then bail is not granted to you. You are already declared a criminal by the society even before your trial has started. You are arrested by the police. The police hounds you. You are paraded in the court. Yes, it's a very, very serious issue. Very serious issue. And I would feel there is no stopping the court to grant exemplary costs when closing a trial and acquitting a person. And I feel the High Courts, 482, when they come across provisions where an FIR is absolutely misconceived, they should come down very, very heavily against the person who is the complainant. Mind you, not against the police authorities. They are unfortunately bound by the provisions of Section 154, 155 and 156. But especially the person who files the complaint. Yes, it's a very, very valid point. Yes, I've answered my question, Vikasji. Hello? Are we there? Hello. Have Yeah. Can you hear me now? Can anybody hear me now? I cannot unmute myself as the host has muted all participants. Hello. नहीं मैं कभी म्यूट हो जाता हूँ कभी अनम्यूट हो जाता हूँ.
Yes.
अब मुझे सुन रहा है.
Yes. वो actually उधर से फोन्स बहुत आ रहे हैं जी. I would be very candid कि हमें अलाउ क्यों नहीं कर रहे. The difficult time is explaining people कि जो बाहर चले गए कि why I have been thrown out and why I have not been allowed to go. Now again four people are on the waiting.
अच्छा.
तो मेरे को तो request करनी पड़ेगी अगर हो सके तो evening में एक बार दोबारा आ जाए. Again three people are there. Yes, Mr. Bali, you can go. Continue.
Yes, me. I just asked. Somebody's question. Any more questions? You can just anybody.
Just hold on. Nilesh Bhardwaj asks, my question is against interlocutory orders, revision is not maintainable, but courts interfere in same under section 482. What is correct for the courts to interfere against, whether it is correct for the courts to interfere against an interlocutory orders under section 482?
See, basic judgment is Madhulime, 1977 by the Supreme Court, State of Karnataka versus Madhulime. Where they say there is no bar for the High Court to entertain a petition under Section 482, even if there's a second revision. But I feel that 482 is a very powerful section. There are certain judgments by the Supreme Court, which are in the mid-90s, where they say that for any other power where the Criminal Procedure Court empowers the higher courts, like the courts of session, to entertain a revision, the High Court should not generally invoke 482, but lately that concept of law has gone a little bit of change where they say that 482 can be exercised. And I absolutely endorse the later version of the law, and I feel that any judgment which curtails the power of the Constitutional Court to do substantial justice, I do not agree with that point of view. As my point of view as a lawyer. And Nideshi, your question is very valid. I feel that the High Court should not be curtailed by unnecessary technicalities. The High Court has power under 482 to look into an order, even if it's of interlocutory nature. An interlocutory order can also be a very serious order. It does not mean that an interlocutory order is always innocuous. An interlocutory order harming somebody's right, curtailing somebody's right, curtailing somebody's freedom, bringing any kind of a disrepute to him, whether it is interlocutory, whether it is final, if the order is illegal, the High Court has to intervene.
There's one question by Nilesh. He says, as to whether the FIR could be quashed, even if it is being challenged after around 3 years of the registration.
Well, I don't think any problem in that. Yes, you see, there's a point of view. You have to go case by case basis. Let's say an FIR has been registered and 70% of the trial is already over. 80% of the trial is already over. All important witnesses have already been examined and the matter comes to the court and the court actually sees, yes, there is nothing fruitful is going to come for the trial. The court, in those circumstances, can say, all right, I direct the trial court to finish the trial within 2 months. The court knows that the person is going to be acquitted. So why go into the 482 petition where you'll have to issue notice, people will come, they'll file reply, and it might take more time than it actually will take for the trial. But let's give a situation, an FIR registered for the last 3 years and even an investigation report has not been filed. Then why should the High Court not interfere if it's an unnecessary criminal prosecution? So it will depend upon a case-to-case basis.
I don't think there is any other question. If anybody wants to ask, he can ask directly to Mr. Bali by unmuting himself first. Hello.
Yes.
हाँ जी बाली जी गुड मॉर्निंग दिस इज धीरज
हाय धीरज हाउ आर यू कैसे हो आप
बहुत बढ़िया बहुत बढ़िया आई हैव अ क्वेश्चन सर
यस टेल मी
कैन एन एफआईआर व्हिच इज रजिस्टर्ड बियॉन्ड द टेरिटोरियल ज्यूरिसडिक्शन ऑफ द हाई कोर्ट बी क्वाश्ड इन आर्टिकल इन 482 प्रोविजंस अनलाइक आर्टिकल 226 ऑफ द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन ऑफ इंडिया
या इफ यू सी आई अगेन गो बैक टू द प्रोविजन ऑफ द कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन आर्टिकल 226 क्लॉज 3 व्हिच सेज एनी पार्ट ऑफ कॉज ऑफ एक्शन And in Majithia's case, I think it was an FIR which was sought to be quashed in Mumbai or in West Bengal, where the Supreme Court says a part of cause of action or majority part of cause of action has happened in one court, but within the jurisdiction of one court, but the FIR has been registered in some other high court. So you basically will have to see whether somebody has created a jurisdiction to harass somebody. Let's take an example. So, person's property is situated, let's say, in Punjab. The offense has happened in Punjab. But the person says that I received a call sitting in Karnataka and where I was threatened that my life will be taken away from Section 5506. And therefore, he goes and registers the FIR in Karnataka. I think the Punjab and the High Court will have total absolute jurisdiction to entertain a petition, quash it, quash the FIR if the quashing grounds are made out. Because substantially, whatever has happened in the within the territorial jurisdiction of the Punjab and Haryana.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, good morning.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes.
Sir, good morning, sir.
Morning. Sir, I have a question.
Sir, I'm Dev Shikhar. Can I ask one question?
Puniji, for a minute, to all the participants, whosoever wants to ask the question, he can ask directly. But at least post it on the chat box that he wants to ask a question directly. Otherwise, too many people will be speaking at once. And then we are reminded of the same issue that too many cooks spoil the broth. Let one person post it on the chat box and then we can continue. Thank you for bearing up with us. The person who was asking the question, he can continue.
Yes, please.
Sir, I'm Devashekhar, sir. I want to ask you a question.
Sorry, I didn't get your...
I am Devashekhar. Devashekhar, sir.
Hi, Devashekhar. How are you?
Sir, yes, I want to ask you a question, sir. Is that if there is a delay in filing of charge sheet by, say, 1 day or 10 days or 15 days, is it a good ground for quashing of a charge sheet?
No. If there's a technical statute which says that if charge sheet is not filed within a time period and you cannot file it beyond that, yes, of course, the High Court will entertain. But if the charge sheet is delayed, there is no statutory limitation, then the statutory limitation may be for the purposes of granting you bail, but not for quashing of the FIR unless and until the case is made out for quashing. Okay. Yes, I have answered the question.
Yeah, next is Ayur wants to ask a question. Ayur?
Hello, sir.
Hi, Ayur, how are you?
Hello. I'm good, sir. Actually, I practice at MP High Court at Jabalpur, sir. So, sir, sir, High Court of MP especially, I don't know about the other High Courts, are very averse to entertaining petitions under Article 226 for quashment. Mm-hmm. So, how do I choose between 226 and 482? Because normally the 482 petitions are being heard by judges who are promotee judges in MP High Court specifically. And 226 petitions are heard by the directly elevated judges who have a very good hand over the matter.
Yes,
but
yes.
I can't do that. So our 482 petitions are never heard.
All right. Yeah, you have a paper and a pen?
I'll just have it one.
First of all, show your video also.
Yes, sir. One second.
You take down judgment, 4 judgments, Pepsi Foods, B.S. Joshi, Lalita Kumari,
yes sir,
and Madharao Jivaji Sindhya. Please,
all right, sir.
Request your High Court yes. on judges when you file a petition under Article 226.
Yes, sir.
Assist them, read those judgments to them. There is no bar
yes, sir.
to enter
yes, sir.
26. portion of a criminal procedure or criminal prosecution. The powers are much. The powers are not curtailed by the technicality of 482, right?
All right, sir. I'm sure
with your good advocacy and persistence, you on law, you will advocate before the honorable court. They will definitely start entertaining and drafting.
I'm hopeful, sir. Thank you so much.
Vishal Agarwal, you can pose your question.
Good morning, sir. Vishal, this side, your neighbor, Vishal Agarwal.
How are you?
I'm good, sir. How are you? All well?
I'm fine. Absolutely
just fine. Small question you had stated. So if the matter, there is a slight smell of civil dispute, it should ordinarily be entertained and quashed as well, the FIR. Mm-hmm. Now, of late, there is a view that the parallel proceedings can continue, be it civil and criminal. Now, how do you distinguish that and what do you comment upon that thin line, that fine line to distinguish whether those parallel proceedings can continue or not?
All right, I must, maybe lack of communication, not a small smell of civil dispute, which smells of civil dispute. Small smell can be, I mean, will be a very, very vague statement to make on a portion of an FIR. Now, as far as the parallel proceedings are concerned, see, it will all go on a case-to-case basis. I can assure you, you go to a good legal mind and you give him a civil case, he can make something criminal out of it also, right?
True.
But you have to basically say what is the fabric of the case. Now, I'll just give an example that somebody files a suit for recovery against you because you have forged a document and there's an FIR registered against you under Section 471 also. So you go to the court and say, look here, there's a parallel civil proceeding going against me. Obviously, then both the proceedings have to go parallelly because you are being prosecuted for forging a document, but the document has caused a lot of financial hardship to somebody, so he's filed a damage or a case of recovery against you. But let's say an example that there's a, like I gave at the beginning of my talk, there's a suit for specific performance or there's a contractual obligation that you had to deliver some goods to somebody and you could not deliver those goods and some advance payments had come to you, right? And that the person registers an FIR and also files a case against you for seeking civil damages or compensation, then you can say, come on, sir. Where is the criminality in this case? So it will depend upon case to case basis.
Right. Thank you,
sir. Mr. Bali, Ankit wants to ask you a question. Ankit, you can come on the board. Ankit.
Good morning, sir. Morning. My question, sir, would be if after the filing of the charge sheet and before the charges are framed, the magistrate has a power to amend the charge if a separate offense can be seen in the charge sheet or the FIR.
Yes, yes.
But in such a case, if you the intent to push the FIR instead of allowing to go to the magistrate and accordingly get the charges amended.
Ankit, just hold on. I'm asking since Mr. Sapan is the host. Sapan, just mute everybody except for Ankit and Mr. Bali and myself. Sapan?
Okay, I'm doing.
Okay. Yes. Ankit, you could repeat your questions. And Mr. Bali, time and again, we are all learning in this process. The entire process is slightly going haywire the way it shouldn't have gone. It is going that way.
I'm absolutely not technically savvy.
Yeah, good morning, sir. This is Advocate Ankit Desai.
I would want
to ask, sir, after the filing of the charge sheet and before the charges are framed, the magistrate has all powers to amend the charge and add a separate offense if the main offense of the FIR is not made out.
Yeah.
So in such a situation, when the ingredients of another offense can be prima facie seen in the charge sheet and the FIR, should the High Court interfere to quash that FIR or should it be allowed to be amended and the person should be allowed to file a discharge application at the trial court stage? Thank you.
See, I feel, Ankitji, this will again go on a case-to-case basis. Let's say there is somebody makes, you see, you know the law that a lesser offense suppose your FIR is registered under section 467, 471. And the court says, no, it can be only under 406, right? So there's a lesser offense. Then the charge, if it's already framed, be amended, or if it is very rare that the charge will be amended, because they say if you tried for a higher offense, a lower offense can all be, you can ultimately finally be convicted for a lower offense. But this will be based upon a case-to-case basis. If you already have all the provisions where a charge has been altered or an offense has been altered to make appropriate applications before the magistrate, it technically may not come out to be a case for caution of the FIR unless until you make a case for caution to say that even this offense is not made out against you. So it will again all depend on a case-to-case basis. You cannot generalize this.
Can I add one thing to this?
Yes,
if, sir, after the filing of the charge sheet, it comes to be seen that an attempt of that offense was made and not the actual offense was completed.
Mm-hmm.
So, can the change be made itself or?
But then it will be
in the case of 506, like, sir, if somebody even attempted to.
Intermediate term. Straightforward case for caution. Why not? Where is the offense of attempt to 506 in a criminal procedure or in IPC? None. Maybe a case for discharge.
Okay,
maybe moving an application to section 227 of the CRPC for complete discharge. Why not?
Okay.
Ashish Chauhan wants to.
Or maybe, and the court, are you aware of the powers of the court under section 245 also CRPC? Court at any stage of the trial. When it feels that no offense is made out, then drop the charges straight away.
Ashish Chauhan, you can post your question. Ashish Chauhan. I think Hi. Ashish is no.
Can you Ashish? Hear me?
Yeah, Ashish, show your video. Yourself on the video.
I think there is some disturbance in the video, so I.
Okay, you can.
I just answer the question, sir. As per your guidance, what should be the basic ingredients that the court should look while going for quashing of the FIR?
It's a very, very interesting question. Yes, it goes to the. It's the heart of the issue. See, again, I repeat, a purely civil dispute. A dispute which relates to, let's say, for example, a matrimonial dispute where the entire family is trying to be is being roped in, where you can actually read the FIR and find out, yes, there seems to be something remiss. Cases where the dispute is in relation to financial transactions, which more or less are in fundamental breaches of contracts. Those are the basic things, and obviously cases where somebody's, you know, it apparently shows you that somebody is being victimized, false prosecution, and judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court now, I think it's 2014. I'm sorry, I sometimes forget the names of the citations. But they say that even documents of in unimpeachable character can be seen by the High Court while quashing an FIR. So these are the basic spectrum, but ultimately it will again go on a case-to-case basis. But I again, like that gentleman lawyer had called from Madhya Pradesh, and I could see the pain in his question when he was asking me that why is my High Court not entertaining a 226 petition. I say it does not matter whether it's a 482 or a 226, false prosecution. Illegal prosecution, which is totally unjustified. I think the high courts will be failing in their duties if they do not curtail it at the first instance.
The next question is by Keshav. Keshav?
Sir, good morning.
Hi, Keshav. How are you?
Very good, sir. Sir, I want to just clarify one thing, sir, and ask, sir, what is the best age for quashing of the FIR? It should be before the filing of the challan or after the filing of the challan? And how to get over the dilemma that when we file a petition at the first instance at the registration of the FIR, and then the court says that come after the filing of the challan. And then when we file it after the filing of the challan, then the court says you go and argue it at the stage of charge. How to get over it?
You see, when I was giving my talk, before you asked me this question, this is an example I had brought forth and put forward to all the persons who are listening to me. That actually, unfortunately, Keshavji, is a situation where sometimes, you see, like not only in criminal cases, let's transpose this question on a civil situation where a person goes to the court and the court passes an order to decide the representation.
Sir.
Rather than entertaining the petition. Then the person files a contempt petition that look here, my representation has not been decided. Then that representation is decided and rejected and the matter comes back to the court. So I feel sometimes the courts play a less proactive role in actually entertaining petitions, whether they are civil or criminal proceedings. There can be a case where, let's say it's brought to the court that on notice the state says that we are actually looking into this, and though we have registered an FIR, we assure you that this person is not going to be arrested, and we have changed the investigating officer because he said that because of the investigating officer or his links with the complainant, the case has been entertained and the prosecution has started, but we are looking into it and we assure you that if we find in the investigation nothing is going to come out, so we will not do anything. So these are cases where the court might feel that yes, let's ask the investigating authorities to finish the investigation. But I feel not entertaining a petition and saying that let the investigation be completed, and when you come back to the court after the investigation is completed and saying let the charge be framed, argue everything you are saying in the charge at the time of charge, and when the charge is framed, you come to the court and the court tells you why don't you now file a revision, I think that's scuttling the issue. The court should not do it. The court feels that a player has been registered in a manner or has been registered vexatiously, wrongly, illegally, for whatever reasons, I think it's the bounden duty of the court to interfere, even if it is the second day of the FIR. I don't care. If it does not make out a case, the court has to interfere.
The next question is by Rajiv Joshi. Joshi? Rajiv?
Yes, sir. Sir, I wanted to take...
Get your name, sir. Can you please introduce me? Anybody?
I'm Rajiv Joshi.
Hey, Rajiv Joshi.
I'm Rajiv Joshi.
Hi, Rajiv. How are you?
Fine, sir.
Yes.
We just discussed about the interlocutory orders just some while ago. One of the judgments dealt with interlocutory orders and what they termed as intermediary orders as well.
Yes.
Now, against an interlocutory order, as you know, under 397, there's a bar.
Mm-hmm.
By the revision before the sessions court.
Mm-hmm.
So, which means that we essentially have to invoke the jurisdiction under 482C. Now, one of the benches of our High Court tried to draw a fine line between interlocutory orders and intermediary orders. Can you please throw some more light, especially with reference to Madhu Lumaya's case? And how is this fine line to be recognized by especially our younger lot of lawyers who have to choose the forum of jurisdiction, whether under 482 or the criminal division?
You see, what is Madhu Lemai's case? Madhu Lemai's case is entertainment of a second revision under the garb of 482 by the High Court, right? So, ultimately, what does the Supreme Court say? That in exceptional cases, 482 can be invoked. It does not sometimes mean that you are filing a second revision. It doesn't, because revisional power is both with the session court and with the High Court. Right. Now, the problem stems from the fact that though the power is both with the Sessions Court and the High Court, if you will maintain a revision directly before the High Court will not entertain it and will tell you to go back to the Sessions Court. And ultimately, if you will file a revision where the revision is maintainable, then obviously when you come to the High Court, then sometimes the High Court does not entertain your petition in the Section 482. Now, the problem is, an interlocutory order is not revisable. The petition has to be filed under Section 482. The courts have tried to distinguish between an intermediary order and an interlocutory order. In my humble submission, with all due humility at my command, there is nothing known as an intermediary order in criminal law. There are intermediaries in arbitration, there are intermediaries in civil law, but an intermediary order would otherwise will not be revisable, so you can again file a petition under Section 482. But I feel that wherever the court under statute has a right to entertain, whether it's a bail petition filed directly filed before the High Court, whether it's a revision petition directly filed before the High Court, any cause of a person or a citizen which brings injustice into judicial forum, if that judicial authority has the right under law to entertain, it must entertain, save time of the litigant, not send him back to other courts so that he has a round trip journey coming back to the High Court. Once he has invoked the jurisdiction of the High Court, which he is otherwise entitled to invoke, even though he has an alternative remedy, but that alternative remedy may not be a bar, like revision categorically says session court or High Court. So why do we call it an alternative remedy? It's a remedy which is available in both the two forums. So I think the High Court should absolutely entertain anything which is illegal.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Bali, the next is by Asham Musad. Can you put light on the transfer of the investigation from police to CBI or any other investigating agency?
Well, it will again depend on a case-to-case basis. You know now the constitutional bench...
Though I will just clarify, we are restricted to 482, but still Mr. Bali is going beyond that of the...
I'm kind enough as usual. Whatever limited knowledge of law I have...
No. I just wish that every lawyer would have this little bit of knowledge what you are possessing. Yeah.
So Justice Bhandari, speaking for the Constitution bench, says that under 482 or 226, you can always invoke the jurisdiction of the High Court to transfer a matter into the realm of CBI. The CBI has to be heard. The CBI is constituted under the Delhi Police Act. And there's sometimes opposition by the CBI to say that we do not want to entertain or we do not want to investigate a matter. But giving a matter to CBI at a throw of a hat is absolutely not called for. Yes, matters, the Honorable Supreme Court categorically says, matters which the court feels, if investigated in the state, will not give justice to a person who is a complainant. I think that's the benchmark. That is the complete benchmark. Again, criminal law is so much on case-to-case basis. It cannot be generalized. Basic provisions can be there, law can be there, but it cannot be generalized. Statute is there which prohibits something or which allows the court to do something, that is fine. But on a case-to-case basis, suppose an investigation of howsoever magnitude it is, but if the police authorities are well in their domain to inquire into it, and the court suppose comes to know that some police officer is trying to overall the investigation, trying to take sides either for the complainant or it can be transferred to another police officer, to a higher police officer, SIT to be maintained, but where the conduct of the entire police force or a very heavy duty politician, let's say, is involved, who is in power, where the court feels on that situation that in this case, the investigation will not be fair. Why not go take it to the CBI? But only in these restricted circumstances.
Now, the next question is, Dhaval Bhandari says that he's a bad throat. With his permission, I am also reading that part. Mr. Yes. He asks you, a review of order passed while exercising inherent powers under Section 482. I'm asking because Supreme Court in the case of Motilal versus State of Madhya Pradesh said that the inherent power of the High Court cannot be exercised to review an order, earlier order passed by the High Court, since the power of review is expressly barred under Section 362. But in State versus Navjot Sandhu, the Supreme Court observed that the power could be exercised notwithstanding the powers under Section 397 of this thing, though not against the power under other laws. What are your views? Kindly throw some light.
Because Can you slow down a little bit? The second part, can you just repeat again? In Sandhu's case, I lost you somewhere.
The Supreme Court observed that the power under Section 482 could be exercised notwithstanding the powers under Section 397 or any other provision, though not against the powers under other law. What are your views, or is it a contradictory view of the Supreme Court?
You see, yes.
You have gathered it, or should I repeat the question again?
No. Next time, I will just request you to just slow down a bit. I got what I said. Thank you so much.
No, I can read it again.
Yeah. Okay. All right.
View on review of order passed while exercising inherent powers under Section 482 CRPC. Mm-hmm. I'm asking because Supreme Court in Motilal versus State of Madhya Pradesh said that the
done because of the bar of 362.
Yes, and then the judgment of state was in Udhav Sandhu. What is your view on this?
You see, if I just brush aside judgments for a moment, my view as a lawyer has always been, we must read what the statute says. Now, Section 482 starts with a non-obstantive clause. And the non-obstantive clause says, notwithstanding anything contained in this code. If my memory serves me right, it says, notwithstanding anything contained in this code, the High Court shall have power, etc. to do so, whatever it mentions. Now, Section 362 is contained in the code. It's a non-obstantive clause. Now I ask myself a question. Suppose in Section 482, the High Court has wrongly quashed an FIR on a technical ground. Let's say a statute prohibits filing of a complaint after 6 months of the offense, but the statute has been amended, and that statute has not been brought to the notice of the High Court, and the High Court has quashed the FIR under 482. Do you think the High Court should be left remedyless to undo what it's done wrongly? That is why 482 was there. And that is why I say 226, a wider power, a much wider realm, should be exercised. Now, the second part of your question was that same parameters, as far as Section 397 is concerned, your question was that under Section 397, there is a bar by the High Court to entertain a revision. But I'm sorry, what was the second part of the question?
I'm just reading that. It was interwoven with State of Navjot Sandhu. The Supreme Court observed that the powers under Section 482 CRPC could be exercised notwithstanding the powers under Section 397 or any other provision of the
law. That is fundamentally absolutely different concept of law. 397 talks about the power of the High Court and the Sessions Court, collateral powers, similar powers to entertain revisions. Now, suppose you file the revision before the Sessions Court, you again label a petition under Section 397 and file it before the High Court, it will be a second revision. The statute doesn't permit it. But the scope of 362 is totally different. It's not filing a revision, it's a review. There's a huge difference between a review and a revision. For a review, the basic fundamentals of what we have under Order 47, Rule 1 and 2 will apply. It is something which could not be brought to the notice of the court, or technically, arithmetically is wrong, which fundamentally is incorrect. So that is this limited scope of review. That limited scope of review should also be read into 482. It's not be a re-argument of everything. But the gamut of both 397 and 482 review is totally different.
Amit Prasha wants to ask you a question.
Yes, Amit.
Amit, are you on the board?
Yeah. Hello. Sir, what is the proper stage of filing of the question of FIR? Is it immediately after the FIR, registration of the FIR, or after the presentation of challan, or even after the framing of charge? However, the framing of charge, we can move to the revision against the charge before the session court. And the documents which we can place before the Honorable Court while filing the petition under Section 482. I remember there was a judgment of Justice S.P. Sinhar regarding regarding this.
Mm-hmm.
So I just want to know which should be the what should be the proper stage of filing the question of FIR.
No, okay, Amit, I'll answer this. I again say criminal jurisprudence is so much a criminal initiation of any petition to Section 42 is so much dependent upon the facts of each case. Now it cannot be in a straight jacket formula. Let me give you 2-3 examples. Now suppose there's an FIR registered against somebody which says again that this consignment was to reach to me on a particular date. This is the contract. I have given the money in advance, but the consignment has not reached me, right? And therefore there is cheating, etc., 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 etc. Now, suppose that petition is filed the next day of the registration of the FIR or after 4 days of the registration of the FIR without invoking the bail provisions straight away to the High Court. How ridiculous is this, right? Now, the High Court calls upon the other side. The other side says, yes, I am the complainant. The goods have now reached me, but they are not of good quality. Why should anybody wait for the investigation to get over in this case? Why? Why should this FIR should have been lodged in the first place? Somebody says that, all right, simple FIR is this, that I agreed to buy a property of 2 crores. I paid 25 lakhs in advance. And on the day fixed, the person never came. And the FIR is registered. But there can be cases. There can be cases. Now, let's take the second situation. Now, there can be cases like the first example I gave you. The person says that, look here, I paid for the goods. But that person does not even have a license to manufacture that goods. And he has taken money from me. But during the course of investigation, it is found out that the person did not have the license to manufacture the good, but he had a subcontract with somebody. But he still took the money. Then that is the stage where you go for quashing after the investigation.
That's right.
So it will all depend on a case-to-case basis.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
And I would also add here, Amitji, I'm sorry again as a lawyer, and I'm sure you people also must have had felt the pain of this situation where all documents being produced before the court, though the Supreme Court says that the session court should not hold a mini trial while framing a charge, but the Supreme Court also says that the session courts or the courts below are not rubber stamps. Can you imagine that how casually the charges are framed after looking into the documents in a cyclo-style manner?
That's right.
I really wish that the courts, while framing charges, absolutely do their duty by looking into the entire documentation presented by the investigation and do not act as rubber stamps and finish unnecessary criminal prosecution at that stage.
But sir, at the same time, sometimes the court says that if you are having so much of documents in your favor, go before the trial and claim acquittal there. So this is one of the problem we are facing.
You see, Amitji, the problem is that documents, sometimes the court might have a valid reason to do so. I'll tell you why. Suppose there are documents which are self-supported, which still have to go through the situation of trial, right? Now, suppose there are documents, suppose the state has registered an FIR against you and you produce on record notifications which are statutory before the High Court and said, because of these notifications, no offense can be made out against me.
That's right.
So, why to prove those documents will go to trial court?
That's right.
So, it can be both ways.
Thank you.
Ankit Dhawan asks, wants to ask a question about an FIR registered against a heinous offense. Ankit, you can ask the question.
Yes. Good afternoon, sir. Sir, I'm Ankit, practicing in Delhi courts.
Hi, Ankit. How are you?
Good, sir. Sir, the problem lies when the false case is registered of heinous crimes, like rape and dacoity or something which is made by the lawyer itself and a complaint is filed. And the problem is when we go to the High Court, under 482, the High Court straight away says prima facie there is a heinous offense and we don't deem proper to interfere in a heinous offense and it's a matter of trial. Let the trial go on because quashing a heinous offense at this stage is not proper.
Yes.
But sir, in the trial itself, the complainant fails to appear or the prosecutrix or the complainant avoids the hearing because somewhere he or she knows that the case is false. Can this be a ground in 482 taken to show the court that this is a false heinous crime, heinous case? And also the fact that the harassment and the hardship faced by the accused is much more in these kind of offenses, for which the High Court should interfere for quashing the FIR.
Yes, you see, when I started my talk, I said there is a very unfortunate system which we face, which is the provisions of section 154, 155 and 156, which were pre-independence time, and the legislation has not taken care to bring about amendments in these provisions. And it also stems from the fact that in our country, we do not trust anybody. So we never trust the person on the ground who is the policeman who gets the complaint or who registers an FIR, who goes ahead and continues the investigation. So therefore, if there was a system that if cognizable offense is reported and the before registration of an FIR, before arresting people, before harassing people, some substantive investigation can be done. And then a person can be said, all right, there's no offense made out. People would not have to, go to 482 or be harassed. Now the problem is that our legislation does not cater for it. Now these cases in relation to heinous crimes like dacoity, like robbery, etc., are so much in relation to a non-documentation or crime, or a crime which person has to prove beyond doubt, or a person has to prove that he's not guilty, unfortunately cannot be scuttled under 482. But there are exceptions. Now, I did a case, I'll tell you, about 10 years back, in which a married man and a married woman had an affair. And they decided that they are not going to get divorced from their spouses. And a married man and an unmarried woman. So they decided they are not going to take a divorce. And they started living together, and they lived together for 10 years. And that woman was also a business partner with that person's daughter for 5 years. Now they fell apart. And then she registered an FIR under Section 376 to say that he never told me that he was not divorced. Now, that was absolutely obnoxious. The person stayed behind bars for three months. We ultimately filed a petition for quashing, which was entertained. So these are exceptional cases, where ultimately it's absolutely clear that a person is being involved mischievously. Let's say a person is involved in a case of dacoity or robbery on a particular date, and his passport stamp shows that he was in Australia that time or in the US that time, he's not even there. So there could be a case not for quashing even at that stage, but to call the police, make sure that the person is not harassed, he is not arrested. The High Court can always under 226, 482 stay arrest of anybody. It is not necessary that somebody should invoke the provisions of 438 or 439. And then have a substantive investigation at a very, very fast pace. Suppose the offense is not proved, filing of the investigation, and then obviously, which I say is the need of the hour, to strictly, strictly deal with people who misuse criminal prosecution.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Yeah. Sonal Chauhan says, in case of a quash inquiry where the accused has been exonerated, will that inquiry hold a valid ground to quash the FIR under Section 482? It is pertinent to note that the contents of the complaint registered under the sexual harassment case and the FIR are the same.
You see, problem with our legal system is that things don't end. So suppose there's a inquiry done under the sexual harassment case and the person who is a complainant has filed an appeal. Now that appeal is pending. The documents are the same. But then you go for quashing. The quashing court will say that if you are making the basis of that inquiry for quashing of the FIR, but the appeal is still pending, what do you do? But I feel in a case of sexual harassment, the evidence, the documents, etc., are all going to be the same. If there's a sexual harassment inquiry, which is continuing in terms of what Vishakha guidelines are, and the statutes which all the states have made, or in private working places people have made guidelines. If there is a criminal case registered on the same thing, at least the High Court should state, let the report of the inquiry come. And the High Court can also always examine the report of the inquiry vis-a-vis the criminal offences. If there is something more made out in a criminal offence which is not a part of the inquiry, the High Court can very well say that the trial should continue. But suppose it is dicto same, and suppose it is upheld in appeal, and after that the petition has been filed in the High Court, that has also been dismissed, then why continue the criminal case? I don't think there will be any point in doing so. Yes, I have answered my question, sir.
Yeah. Apoorgar asked, given in the present circumstances, adversarial system has more drawbacks than the inquisitorial system, then many countries follow, where accused is also given an opportunity in participating in the investigation, and the quest is towards finding the truth rather than finding the evidence against the accused. What is your take?
Yes, of course. That's why we say that we are outdated in this. We are absolutely dated. We are still invoking the provisions of section 154, 155, 156. And they were somewhere there in 1870s, 1860s. And we are still invoking these provisions because I feel an accused who is wrongly involved in a criminal prosecution is a bigger loser than a person who just simply files a complaint and goes to the police authorities and an FIR is registered. So yes, there has to be active participation of the accused in the crime. The investigating officer should be a person of very high credibility. We should trust them. We should trust the system. And absolute power should be there to have a pre-investigation stage and file a case which is absolutely needless.
So because...
Apoorva says.
Yes. Because I have seen many times when the police person comes to us, when we ask for his mobile record, location record, he says that we had collected it, but we have not appended it with the challan because the location was of somewhere else, which is not supporting our case. Mm-hmm. So that is why I think he should collect all the evidence and put that evidence before the judge, before a magistrate, so that he can apply his mind, look into the every aspect, and then decide whether the charge has to be framed against him or not in the light of all these evidences. When we keep evidence with ourselves, we don't disclose that evidence, we don't allow an accused to show any document at the time of framing of charge, then I think the whole system of fails.
The misfortune of our criminal system is, and again I say it stems from outdated provisions, is that once an FIR is registered, it kind of becomes a duty of the investigating officer to file a charge sheet always, in most of the circumstances, filing something against the accused. So he will only put that evidences which prima facie make a case out against the accused and then file a charge sheet accordingly. And it's a point which is very, very valid by you. The accused, suppose in a matter, can actually show to the investigating officer that the allegations against him are baseless. That should be made a part of the record. It should, because you see, the real justice giver in the criminal system, in my humble submission, is not the court. Is the person who's investigating, is the SHO, is the person who registers your complaint. Both ways. Whether the complaint is genuine or the complaint is absolutely malicious. The person to give you immediate justice is the person who has to investigate the matter. And I am absolutely convinced with you, he should be armed with enough statutory power to actually have both point of views, place all documents on record. And if he does not place on record the documents which the accused has given to show his innocence, or even the complainant has given to show that the accused is guilty, he should be severely reprimanded.
Right, sir. Thank you so much.
Most welcome. Yeah, I can hear you.
There's another question from Mr. Ankur. If I probably Mr. Vikas is busy, can I read?
Yeah.
Hello.
From Chandigarh?
Process back.
Yeah. Ankur Sehgal asks, criminal and civil proceedings. Again, same. Hello.
Yes, yes.
Criminal and civil proceedings against same person pertaining to the same issue. What is the effect of decision of civil court on criminal proceedings or vice versa? Whether decision of civil court would be relevant in criminal proceedings or vice versa?
You see, again, when I started my talk, I said that unfortunately for us, the judgments and the law on a lot of topics in this country has not been very consistent. Initially, the judgments were that whatever are the findings of the civil court in a absolute similar offenses concerned will prevail over the findings of a criminal court for a very simple reason that in a criminal court to get the offense into a situation of conviction, you have to go beyond reasonable doubt. But in a civil court, that parameter is not there. But somehow the law took turn where the Honorable Court said that civil and criminal proceedings, even on the same situation, can go hand in hand. And ultimately, the courts have a very divergent view on this. They have said that if it is the same offense, maybe in civil case, you make out, you don't make out a case, but there still can be criminality attached to it. So, my opinion would always be, and there are judgments to support this opinion, that there's a huge divergent view in this. But I would say that if the offense is same and the allegations are same, criminal proceedings should be stayed. Civil proceedings should be decided expeditiously by an order of a court. If ultimately in the civil dispute, something comes up, let's say it's a forgery of a document. Somebody has tried to do something, there's a forgery of a document, there's serious issues, and the civil court findings are in favor of the complainant, then obviously the trial can continue. There can be a situation where the offenses are so heinous in civil and criminal both that both have to go on parallelly. But if it's a purely civil dispute amongst two individuals and the criminal case is also registered, then I would say that the better way would be that the civil court should be given precedence. But yes, if there's a super heinous crime which also has civil bearing and a criminal bearing and the documents are same, then obviously it will go on a case-to-case basis where both can simultaneously continue.
Mr. Bali, though we had sought the leave that the session would be over by 12:30.
Yes, yes.
Now two questions are there. We will not entertain any other questions because Mr. Bali has been kind enough that he has acceded to our request that he would take another session of ours. Since more people were willing to participate today, but due to certain unforeseen circumstances, we could not go ahead with that. And last two questions for your good self would be, Vikas, Bali, you can come on the board and ask the question directly. Bali?
Here I am.
Yeah.
Hello, yeah.
Hello, how are you?
Good, yeah, how are you? So good. My question was, there was a situation in which a complainant, being the husband of the wife, he filed a complaint taking some allegations against his in-laws and the wife. Those allegations were found to be false on three occasions. Mm-hmm. And after that, I filed a petition under 482 seeking directions from this Honorable Court that some action may be taken against this person because he is filing frivolous complaints. Mm-hmm. On that, it given in reply that they won't be receiving any frivolous complaints and they won't be taking any action on those. But the petition was disposed of. Thereafter, yet another complaint was filed and straight away an FIRs were registered against the in-laws family and they were forced to face the trial. The challan has also been presented. The charges have also been framed and I suppose one or two prosecution witnesses have also been examined. So at now this stage, can I file a caution of the FIR?
Of course. Why not?
Because it's already been now the charges have also been framed and the evidence has also been.
I can come to the conclusion that this is something which is a clear violation of an undertaking given before
exactly.
the court.
Exactly.
Now, you see, undertakings given before the court or affidavits filed before the court are of very, very serious nature. Yeah. So unless and until the prosecution can answer the High Court to say that, look here, this was the third complaint. This complaint, when investigated, this is the heavy material which has come across us, where we have actually found extreme material to start prosecution. But the right way for the state should have been that you should have moved an application before the High Court, brought that material on record, and then taken permission of the court to start a prosecution. In my submission, that this order is absolutely in teeth of what the court has said. And if the High Court cannot honor its own order, then God help his country, then which other authority will?
Well, that was the situation in which they wanted to get the matter disposed of, and thereafter immediately they got a new complaint and the FIR was registered without even getting the inquiry being conducted.
No, but I think that it brought to the notice of the court that this technical issue, that two prosecution evidences have been led.
Yeah.
I'm sure that you might have a good case to go to the High Court still.
Thank you so much.
Mr. Bali, Harveet Sehgal has asked certain judgments that some other person in the group will help him.
Uh-huh.
And Dev Shekhar asks, when cognizance of a charge sheet has been taken by a court and uh-huh. the accused does not appear and is declared a PO, and uh-huh. thereafter accused appears, does statutory bail apply?
Statutory bail, yes, of course. Why not? So there are proclaimed offender proceedings. The orders are passed for proclaimed offender, being a proclaimed offender. And once you submit to the jurisdiction of the court, then obviously you can apply for bail. There is no bar on that.
Bar.
So, Mr. Bali, all the questions are over. Before I ask Mr. Suveer to formally give a vote of thanks, I would just like to say three different perspectives of the entire meeting. Mr. Bali, you are there?
Yes, I'm there. I'm back here.
The fact that we are having lawyers from... hello?
Yes, hello, there.
The fact that we are having lawyers from Delhi, Jabalpur, etc., and the fact that the large number of the lawyers could not attend the meet, firstly shows your popularity amongst the lawyers, which is limited to Chandigarh itself. You are as powerful as 482 or 226, number one. Number two is the fact that we have been holding meetings for this is around 10th meeting of ours.
Mm-hmm.
Invariably, at the initial stages, the meeting has the full strength and gradually it generally comes down to the 60-70%. But the interesting feature today is that we are in and around hovering around the 90%. And large number of persons could not be later on admitted because they thought that it was high time trying. And there was no black of this session.
Mm-hmm.
Those who made it, but they couldn't even buy the tickets in the black because it was all free. So the free had to be multiplied by free.
Mm-hmm.
Third is that we all came with every lawyer came with a canvas, colors, and a thought process how to go about it under section 482, what would be the process. Mm-hmm. The painting which you have ultimately made it on the canvas. If I would be having a curator, I could definitely say that these paintings of the entire gamut which you have given today would sell much better price than what MF Hussain could have done it. And now to Mr. Suveer. Suveer?
Thank you, Vikasji. Sir, good evening. Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Sir, just an addendum to all the questioners, because I could not gather them up to earlier ask, sir, because there was a lot of line of questioning. Sir, I recently saw that you were one of the panelists along with the DGP Punjab and the Chief Secretary on the NDTV town hall, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Sir, in that you had specifically mentioned that the police reform, it is very important for those police officers who actually register and create documents to be well informed and to mm-hmm. know what is the application of law and to what section applies where. Sir, yes, how
is staffing on this? I think the NDPS issues and drugs in Punjab, I think you're talking about.
Yes, sir, the NDTV town hall, sir. Yes. Sir, how important it is for these police reforms to come into being for the reduction of the cases of 482, and would these police reforms, even if they be there and even if the police officers are given adequate kind of a knowledge, even then the 482 application will be the same as it is now, sir?
Oh, you know, you see, this is a question of very wide spectrum, but I'll just curtail the answer into two main issues, and they're very, very important issues. And I'm very disturbed that as a lawyer, as a citizen, that our legislators and our policymakers do not look into these aspects. Let's talk about aspect number one. The policeman today, who is guarding you, who's looking after law and order, is basically akin to a soldier who's on the border, protecting your border with your neighboring countries. Because we are never in a situation of war. We are not in a situation of war. Our country has not seen a war for the last 40 years. But we've seen war within the state, within the country, amongst people, law and order situations. Have you ever introspected that what do we give to the policeman on the ground? The person is not armed properly. There are no working hours for him. These are no benefits given to him. There is not a canteen like an army man has a canteen that the person he can buy subsidized rations. The salaries are always monitored by the IAS officers because the police does not have an independent financial situation. The housing for the policemen, especially the class 3 policemen or the policemen at the lower level, is absolutely horrendous. It is pathetic. And after all of that, we expect these policemen to be absolutely honest, do their duty diligently. Where 25% or 30% of them is unfortunately in certain states will be doing guard duties or VIPs. So this is one aspect of the administration where somebody has to have a very, very serious look to get the best people, to get the best people on board, and to ensure that these people who do so much of heavy duty, because they are the first point of call of justice to a common man, they should be looked after. And secondly, yes, the statutes have to be adequately amended so that A, the investigations are proper, B, if a complaint is genuine, it must be brought to the logical conclusion, and C, if the accused is victimized, then a false complaint should not live for long and disturb a person who is otherwise innocent.
Right, sir.
Sweet formal vote of
yes,
thanks.
Sir. Yes, sir. Sir, thank you. Thank you so much for being there. Thank you so much for your precious time, sir. It is a delight as always to hear you inside the court and now, of course, outside, sir. And thank you.
I'll also give a vote of thanks to everybody. I mean, we are all sitting in very difficult times, and I really wish all the people who are hearing me out, they stay safe, they stay healthy, their families are safe. And on the lighter side, time is what everybody has right now, because nobody is doing anything. So nobody's time is precious right now. And I'm actually thankful to you people that you got me on board and I was able to give my point of views, which I actually now think were beyond the scope of 482, but it was my pleasure. And thanks to everybody who's been here and who's been listening to what I have said and the questions I have answered. And there are certain views which I have given which are beyond the realm of law or statute, but those are my personal views as a lawyer. So I'm sorry if I have maybe not told the views or lines of certain other people, but those are my personal views.
No, sir.
Yeah, we want. But yeah, we want you to this come side. Again,
Mr. Pali.
And I would just like to say one thing, Puneet ji.
Yes, yes, sir.
This is VK Sachdeva.
I'm
good. How are you, sir?
Absolutely fine.
It has been 1 hour and 45 minutes non-stop listening to you.
Mm-hmm.
I have an experience of listening to you more longer than this. And I've always maintained, and today will again reiterate, that we have a diamond among ourselves. I'm saying so openly at this platform. And we all have been today very, very lucky to hear your valuable views. And thanks to you that you have come here to join all of us, boss.
No, thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
We want you to come here again.
Mr. Bali. Mr. Bali, before we part.
Yes.
Though we had initially taken the commitment that you would come again, So I will take a separate appointment for you from you that when you are coming back. I am reminded of, we had always seen the sequels, but I never thought that even the proceedings, we can have a sequel. So we will request that there should be a sequel from Bali too.
Absolutely.
Definitely, Vikas. It will be my pleasure. And thank you so much. And I again wish everybody very, very safe and healthy times. And I really wish that we overcome this great crisis which has taken over the world very soon.
And before we part, two issues. Those who want to connect, they can connect on the WhatsApp group, Beyond Law. They can like our page, Beyond Law. They will be updated. Or they can contact on the mobile number 9872503300. Stay blessed. Today we will not be having a session because we will the evening session, but because we will be working out the modalities as to how we can have more and more participants rather than having participants waiting in the waiting list. Thank you. Stay blessed. We will catch up tomorrow. Tomorrow we are having a session from Anirudh Krishan. He will be telling upon the force majeure, COVID-19 effect, lease and agreement effects, and so on. And as we said, Wednesday is for Mr. Patwalia, Mr. Amit Rawal, Justice Amit Rawal, Justice Arun Pali. They have also all agreed. They will also come on board. Thank you. Stay blessed.
Bye-bye.
I am ending the meeting now.